Welcome to Security Now, your source for cybersecurity news and interviews with your hosts, Ken Hess and Preston Smith.
A little bit about myself. That's generally the hardest question to answer, right? I'm an attorney. I've been an attorney for about 10 years, focusing mainly on business litigation, on both sides of the V, plaintiff and defendant. Over the last about 3 to 4 years, I've developed an interest in cybersecurity and how it relates to the law and how lawyers should be involved in this process. So I've been starting with advice and working on contracts on the risk management side of cybersecurity, which is pre-litigation, hoping to avoid litigation and knowing what I know about litigation, being able to prevent my clients from getting into it is where I'm steering my practice a little bit more. Eller and Detrich is a firm here in Tulsa. It's about mid-size. We have approximately 16 lawyers, I believe, now. And we do litigation, business litigation, as well as transactional, a lot of real estate development, zoning, and estate planning. And we also actually have a CPA that does tax as well. So the firm kind of spreads out to a lot of different business needs from that perspective. And it's been around since Phil Eller and Don Dietrich started it many years ago, and I've been very fortunate to be here since 2015. The how-to is a hard question. How to engage a firm, especially mine, in litigation or in any kind of services, it starts with a phone call generally. Sometimes an email anymore with cybersecurity threats and phishing emails. Sometimes that's the worst way to start a conversation if you don't know somebody. Referrals as well. A lot of our work we do is for the same clients that come back again and addressing needs as they come up. But as far as the cybersecurity need, picking up the phone and calling a lawyer and saying, I need to address cybersecurity is a starting point, because ultimately there are so many different ways you can address cybersecurity with a lawyer that there really is no one way to get it going. Sometimes it starts as a clause in a real estate contract or an escrow agreement that you find out has some sort of cybersecurity twist or liability shifting, and at that point should raise some red flags that, hey, maybe I should get a lawyer to look at this part that has some sort of expertise in cybersecurity. And so just picking up the phone and calling the lawyer that you have on task, if you have an in-house counsel, starting there, and they can determine what expertise they have in that aspect and decide when to engage outside counsel. It goes both ways. You've got the conversation starting with somebody calling you because something has happened. Generally, they need help and they don't know what to do, what the next step is. Other times they think, I don't understand this. And so they call an attorney to seek that out. Really, the calls come in, and most clients don't necessarily know the problem or the issue that they're having. Something comes up that makes them think, maybe I should call a lawyer. Unfortunately, with cybersecurity risk management, a lot of clients don't recognize that issue or that something could be necessary there. And so that's the practice that we're trying to come to, and why I've been working a little bit more on the education side of cybersecurity, because spotting the issue sometimes is the hardest problem. And once that issue is spotted, then calling a lawyer, and they can really nail down what the problem is or could be how it could be prevented. When a hack has occurred, immediate action is necessary. A lot of breaches, for example, are not discovered until they've been going on for a while, generally speaking. From a technical side, I won't get into, how that works or why. There are better, more qualified people for that. But when a breach occurs, the best thing you can do is contact your insurance company, contact a forensic analyst, and contact your attorney. And if you don't have individuals already lined up for those spots, finding the one person that can help you track down the right people to call and to get that analysis done, the first 24, 48 hours are critical in determining what the problem is, how to stop the problem, and then addressing it from that point forward. Sometimes insurance policies actually provide those resources to the insureds, assuming they have obtained the proper coverage in the first place. And they can make one call to their agent and that'll start the process and they'll start getting them hooked up to the right people. There are breach notification laws in 48 of the 50 states, I believe, but maybe 47 or 48. There are a couple that have not yet enacted breach notification laws. Oklahoma is one of the ones that has enacted a law. It does require notification of a breach. The Oklahoma law is only a few sections. It's not very detailed, and it does provide safe harbors if you are complying with federal law, for example, in breach notification. If you have HIPAA records and you have to follow the Office of Human Rights requirements for notification, then you are complying with Oklahoma law. However, you are also required to notify the Attorney General and get proper authorities involved to the extent there's criminal involvement in the hack, and which generally there is. And at times they can ask you not to provide notification because it might impede the investigation. And in such cases, you'll also be under a safe harbor from notification. The trick with notification, however, is making sure that you actually do have a breach, rather than somebody hit a wrong button on a machine and it looks like a breach, and then all of a sudden you've notified 450 customers of a breach and you spent all this money and there wasn't actually a breach, and now you have to deal with the PR that goes with that. The implications of an insider threat are various and widespread. You've got a couple of different concerns with insider threat, and it's not just the inside bad actor, but you also have the inside unaware actor. And sometimes the lack of training of your employees is just as bad as having and hiring the wrong person. Ultimately, you could do every background check in the world and you may not catch the criminal that's going to come in and steal your items. But if you have policies in place to help train your employees and avoid social engineering attacks, for example, then you can lessen that risk. And so some of the problems with insider threat can be accomplished, or some of the problems can be resolved by certain preventative procedures in place beforehand. After it has occurred is another set of issues and a different aspect to look into. You have the issue of whether or not you have insurance coverage. If it is an insider threat, sometimes you don't have coverage for that because it's a criminal act and it's by an insider, and perhaps you've got an exclusion for acts of the insured and that they're acting on your behalf. Or if you have, on the other side of the coin, you have an unaware employee that was not trained and a phishing attack comes in and they wire a bunch of money out based on an email that they believe was from the president or the CEO of the company, that was a voluntary act by that person. And if you don't have the proper coverage for social engineering, a lot of times those activities are excluded from your insurance policy. And so you do have insurance concerns as it relates to both of those. And then thereafter, the type of recourse, if it is an employee that you've got a contract with, always you've got a breach of contract claim that you can make for somebody that's doing something outside. You can terminate the employee. It's harder when you have an employee that has never been trained and doesn't know what the rules and requirements are, and they're acting in a way that seemed like the way that the entire business has been operating. And so thus the training comes important on the front end. But you also have negligence claims, breach of fiduciary duty claims, as well as criminal prosecution. To the extent you've got an intentional act by someone that's purposefully taking action on the inside, there's Oklahoma Computer Fraud Claims Act as well that can be prosecuted against somebody that's doing something to the electronic data in your company. And so then you've got those recourses against the employee. Of course, if it's an employee and it's a low-level employee, recourse may mean nothing to the company, because ultimately the company will also likely be liable to a third party as a result of these issues. And that liability can range from causes of action filed in a lawsuit or regulatory fines, not to mention the third party or first party costs that come with having to fix the problem and the reputation that damage has come as well. Our practice is leaning towards getting companies in the best position they can be in to protect against those third-party claims. Right now, the landscape for data breach litigation and you know, other types of cyber litigation is broad. And it's the Wild West right now. Nobody really knows where it's going. Nobody knows what all the insurance policies are saying. There's going to be litigation about coverage. There's going to be litigation about responsibilities and duties on companies. And the more sophisticated the hackers become, it's starting to cause more duties to be placed upon companies to maintain that confidentiality and privacy of the information that they have in-house. And a lot of the standards, however, involve reasonableness. And the question is, what does reasonableness mean? You've got that definition that can range, and it depends on the type of company, the industry that they're in, the data that they're holding, and what activities they're doing to maintain that. And so for my purposes, I'd like to assist my clients in getting their position and their company in the best position it can be in to prevent any risk going forward. I would like my clients to not be the test case for that insurance policy or for that liability to a third party. And so if we can do everything we can that's reasonable and that's cost effective and making sure that companies are covered from that perspective, then I've done my job. And the cost that you put in the front end is never going to be as much as you put in on the back end if you have to litigate it. And it's one of those cost-benefit analyses that a lot of companies are not doing yet. And so educating our clients right now as to what needs to be done and how they can protect themselves is first and foremost what I find to be important. And that education will help them determine how they best can protect themselves in a cost-efficient manner. Because sometimes, I do know that Jerry Dawkins with True Digital Security has spoken, and he talks about, you know, you can't just buy the blinky box that'll make you secure. It's got to be a culture-wide change. And if they just keep spending money on blinky boxes, then they won't be doing what's necessary to reasonably protect themselves. And so instead, finding a better use for those funds and being smarter about the investment in cybersecurity is where I hope to help my clients in the future.
Thank you for watching Security Now with Ken Hess and Preston Smith. We'll see you next time. And remember to stay secure.